Good morning and welcome. Please join us in singing Hosanna, loud Hosanna.
Their love from branches waving and singing. Good morning. Welcome. God's peace be with everyone here. This morning it's Palm Sunday. If you would please note your bulletin for announcements this morning. Continuing to remember those listed in prayer. Announcements for the week. Tuesday, we have 8 a.m. men's fellowship and Wednesday, ladies' Bible study at 9:30. We have no supper at evening activities Wednesday due to Holy Week services. Thursday, there will be quilting here from 9 to 3. And then we have our Maundy Thursday service with Holy Communion at 6:30 p.m. Reminding everyone, Maundy comes from that Latin word mandate or mandatum, from which we get mandate. When Jesus gave that command to love one another and the foot washing, and that happened that night. So we always celebrate Holy Communion on that evening and Holy Week, and so we'll gather Thursday. Friday, the Good Friday service is also at 6:30 with special music. If you'd like to share, please let me know or let Whitney know before Tuesday if you could, so we can get the bulletin together. And then next Sunday, we have our Easter services at 8 and 10 with Easter brunch, breakfast in between. We still need some names to volunteer to help clean up, I think, and also to help serve the meal. There looks like sufficient volunteers to bring muffins and so forth, but we do need some folks to help serve and clean. So if you haven't yet put your name on there, we really need help with that. So put your name down there if you can. Upcoming events, April 2nd at 9, there'll be an outreach committee meeting here at the church. April 26th through the 28th is the Spring Women's Retreat in Monaga. And then May 4th, Ladies Spring Tea at the church. And applications for scholarships are on the table, and those completed applications are due May 1st. Thank you to all the janitors for all your work cleaning the church in March. Thanks to Pastor Bruce and Wendy, Kenny and Sarah Matinen, Phil and Julie Eiley, Michael and Heidi Matinen. Next month, note the names there for janitorial, but thank you. I know it's been a long month for that janitorial crew, so thank you to those guys. It's been a lot on your plate, so thank you. Are there any other announcements this morning? Okay, we'll turn it over to Michael for our psalm reading this morning.
Let's begin this service in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our psalm reading for this morning comes from Psalm 118, verses 19 through 29. Psalm 118, 19 through 29. Hear now these words, reading in Jesus' name. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them, and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Save us, we pray, O Lord. O Lord, we pray, give us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God, and he has made his light to shine upon us. Bind the festive sacrifice with cords up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God, I will extol you. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Amen. Please rise if you are able for opening hymn number 70. Ride on, O Savior King.
Thank you.
Please remain standing for our second scripture reading coming from Zechariah chapter 9, verses 9 through 12. Hear now these words reading in Jesus' name. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. Righteous and having salvation is he. Humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. I will cut off the chariot from Ephraim and the war horse from Jerusalem, and the battle bow shall be cut off, and he shall speak peace to the nations. His rule shall be from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth. As for you also, because of the blood of my covenant with you, I will set your prisoners free from the waterless pit. Return to your stronghold, O prisoners of hope. Today I declare that I will restore to you double. Amen. You may be seated. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning rejoicing as we celebrate this Palm Sunday, as our King comes to us. Lord, but he comes on a donkey, not on a white stallion, but on a donkey. And he comes to us not to condemn, but to save, and not to live, but to die, and not to serve, but to serve. Lord, for we understand that our King comes to die on the cross, and he reigns from the cross of Calvary. Lord, forgive us for when we want something else from our King, when we want some earthly leader to come and conquer and establish a kingdom on earth. Lord, we pray that you would continue to remind us over and over that your kingdom is not of this world. Lord, also forgive us for we have not loved you with our whole heart or loved our neighbor as ourself. Lord, we pray that you would have mercy on us, and we ask for your grace. Lord, for we have no claim on any of the gifts that you do give, but we appeal to who you are, which is a gracious and a loving God, who forgives us for the sake of his Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, and we do thank you for your Son, who, as we celebrate, came into Jerusalem on this Palm Sunday. Lord, we thank you that that ultimately led to his death on the cross, which paid for our sins, and that has given to us his righteousness. Lord, we thank you for this. Lord, we thank you for your grace, and we pray that you would equip us to be gracious to those around us. Lord, and that in everywhere we go, that we would bear witness to your Son, Jesus Christ, and what he did for us on the cross. For we know that you take no pleasure in the death of the wicked. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you that it's efficacious and it does what it says. Lord, we pray that you would soften our hearts this morning to hear it and receive the message that you have placed on Pastor Nathan's heart. Lord, we pray for our church here in ESCO that you would continue to guide us in your truth and lead us, and that we would remain faithful to your word. Lord, we pray for other churches around the world for the same, and that they, as they proclaim the word of God, people would be strengthened and encouraged and brought to repentance through this very word. Lord, in that same vein, we also pray for our missionaries as they proclaim this word of gospel. Lord, we pray for Emily, Jay, Robert, and Ula, Derek and Christy Johnson, Larry and May Johnson. Lord, we pray that you'd strengthen them and encourage them, and that they would continue to proclaim this gospel and continue to do your work. Lord, we pray for our brothers and sisters who are being persecuted for the faith all over the world. Lord, we pray that you would give them strength to endure this persecution. Lord, we pray for our government, our national, our state, and our local leaders. We pray that they would have wisdom as they lead, and they would not lead for themselves, but for the better of the whole. Lord, we pray for all those who are suffering. We pray for Raymond Skoglund, Jill Mattson, Louis Berkstead, Sarah Fisher, Dean Jutnan, Chris Hadela, Jessica Lauka, Kurt Barney, Lori Nestrud, Keith Sonneberg, Don and Shirley Magnuson, Richard Jutnan, Bethany Sonneberg, Joanne Mattnan, Bob and Casey Soderberg, John Eiley, Paul Sivney, Judy Marshall, and Eddie and Cheryl Pumula. Lord, we pray for each one of them and that you would give them strength to face whatever they're facing, Lord. And you are the divine healer. Lord, we pray for your healing touch as your will would indicate. Lord, we pray for those who are suffering too around the world from natural disasters and the different wars and the victims of violence. Lord, we pray that you'd bring an end to these wars, and we pray for all those innocent ones that you protect them and keep them in your care. Lord, we pray for our military here in Nils Gettenberg, Bruce McCray, Heath Parks, Hunter Bartow, Steve Lewis, Joshua Blodgett, Jeremy Blodgett, Sean Kangas, Bryce Thunberg, Brant Thunberg, and Reed Sonnenberg. Lord, we pray that you would protect them, and we thank you for the sacrifice that they have made. Same goes, Lord, for our law enforcement and our doctors and nurses and EMTs and firemen. We pray for the sacrifice that they make, and we pray that you'd continue to protect them and guide them as well. Lord, we thank you that you hear our prayers and that we can come to you whenever, and we can go right into the throne of God because of your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you for this now, and we pray that you'd hear us as we pray that perfect prayer which your Son has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Oh,
Thank you to our praise team this morning. The offertory verse from John 12, 26. If anyone serves me, he must follow me. And where I am, there will my servant be also. If anyone serves me, the Father will honor him. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have called us to follow you. And that you gave us this promise likewise that wherever you go, we would be with you. And that wherever we go, that you would be with us. Heavenly Father, we pray then that you would help us to go those paths that you have called us to. Even, Father, if it is marked by a darkness. Lord, we pray that even if we follow the way of pain, be with us, Heavenly Father, for we know that Jesus walked that way for us. We pray that you would bless us in this hour, that you would bless this offering for Jesus' name's sake, and in his name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
May grace, mercy, and peace be with all of you from God our Father and Jesus Christ, his Son, our Lord. Amen. Our text this morning is recorded in the Gospel of John, chapter 12, beginning at verse 12, reading through verse 19. Listen to these words reading in the name of our Lord. The next day, the large crowd that had come to the feast heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. So they took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him, crying out, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, even the King of Israel." And Jesus found a young donkey and sat on it, just as it is written, "Fear not, daughter of Zion. Behold, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt." His disciples did not understand these things at first. But when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things had been written about him and had been done to him. The crowd that had been with him when he called Lazarus out of the tomb and raised him from the dead continued to bear witness. The reason why the crowd went to meet him was that they heard he had done this sign. So the Pharisees said to one another, "You see that you are gaining nothing. Look, the world has gone after him." Amen. Jesus came for no other reason than to fetch us from the darkness and from the grip of the evil one, the spirit of the power of the air, the prince of darkness. And in so doing, he would exert his force full main. And he would demonstrate this in particular by raising one particular man from the dead, as we know Lazarus was raised from the dead. And as Jesus raised him from the dead, not everyone was so impressed with this, though, and this is what is fascinating to us. The chief priests and the scribes thought that this was a demonstration of the fact that Jesus was, in fact, in league with dark forces and a dark power, because they came to this conclusion thinking that he was in some ways connected with this dark power as a rival of the power that was given to them. And they understood then that the threat of this power was a threat to their own. This threat of Jesus was a threat to their clutch, so to speak. And so it says in verse 10, the large crowd of Jews learned Jesus was there. They came not only on account of him, but also on account of Lazarus, whom they had raised from the dead. So the chief priests made plans to put Lazarus to death as well, because on account of him, many of the Jews were going away and believing in Jesus. We find this somewhat astonishing, or completely astonishing. Jesus raises a man from the dead, and they say, you know, he's going after this Jesus who raised him from the dead. Let's go after Lazarus and eliminate him. You know, how are they going to accomplish this? Everybody witnessed this. It was plain to the sight of everyone. We can only imagine how they're going to cover for this. That it must have been some kind of magical ghost or a trick that he played on you. You know, how else are they going to conceive of this, right? Now, we come to this conclusion simply and only for the fact that we have this friendship with our Lord that is given us by the Holy Spirit of God, who has called us and summoned us into his presence, into this relation that we have with him. We think it's in plain sight. You know, we think that it's obvious in some ways that he holds a power that is greater than that of death, which exerts itself over Lazarus. And Jesus has come to challenge this potency and to rival that death and to take Lazarus out of death's clutch. It would seem to be obvious we ought to worship him and adore him. But instead, the chief priests find out how not only to eliminate him, but Lazarus as well. So we read, the next day, the large crowd that had come to the feast, this is the feast of Passover, heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. So they took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him, crying out, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, even the King of Israel." We already know the fickleness of the crowd. You know, it's already been told to us, as John's gospel tells us and invites us into this understanding, that, you know, in the midst of all this praise, all this euphoria that the crowd is experiencing, you know, there's no substitute for the thronging crowd. There isn't. You know, it takes on a life all its own. But we see pictured here already before this crowd assembles. We see pictured here already the scribes, the Pharisees, the chief priests already contemplating how to bring this to an end, standing off to the side, because that's what they do. The entirety of their life is characterized by the fact that they will abstract themselves from the mindless masses who are carried away by their emotions, carried away by that kind of zest that comes to them and the celebratory mood comes over them. They are men who think straightly and who calculate soberly. They are men who recognize that this fray and this mass of rabble is not where it's at. They have already elevated themselves to this position. The chief priests have this by virtue of their calling and their station. The Pharisees have this by virtue of the great, you could say, heroic effort that they've given to the law of God. The scribes, likewise, because of their intellect and their academic acumen, come to this position of height, and they look down on everyone else. And they become judges of everyone else. And even then of themselves. Because remember what they possess. They have the knowledge of good and evil, and they have given themselves to the study of good and evil to such a state that they would be able to judge not only themselves, but others. They're bench warmers. They sit off to the sides and glower at the crowd. The crowd that assembles and in their euphoria praise Jesus for the work that he has done and invite him to Jerusalem now. And we know already what they think this means. One who can overcome death like this, imagine what a captain of the army he would make. Imagine what a flawless victory he would make on the field of battle over our enemies. They welcome him in, expecting him to take the throne of Jerusalem, the true kingdom of God, representative on earth by that throne. Jesus comes into Jerusalem upon a young donkey and sat on it, just as it is written, "Fear not, daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt." What's rather fascinating about this is that kings sometimes would come in this way. It wasn't always a sign of their humility that they come in this way. And this is what's fascinating about it, simply because Jesus comes in as a king would. He comes into the praise of the hosts that gather around him. The humility of Jesus is not necessarily marked by this entrance, but is marked by what he comes to do, by who he is. The power that resides in him, which is not simply one that comes in the style of the powers of this world, or the powers that be, or the power that exerts itself in the strength that it shows over the rabble that now surround him and praise him. Because even they, though they are now riding this wave of euphoria, we know already how fickle they can be. We know that in a few days' time, these ones who are saying, "Hosanna to the Son of David," will cry out, "Crucify him." We know this already. This is already remarked by John, who shows us this kind of, you know, there's in this light, in this beautiful environment, there's this little shadow that's kind of lurking in the background. And in fact, then John says his disciples did not understand these things at first. And this is what is vital for us to understand. Like I said, Jesus raises a man from the dead. It should be obvious to everybody who this man is about. And it isn't. It just flat isn't. It is not obvious. The power that Jesus holds is not obvious. Even though by, I could say, obviously, if you just open your eyes and see, he is not obviously in league with the evil one, but takes Lazarus from the dead. It's pretty obvious. No, it isn't. Even now, as he comes into Jerusalem, the disciples did not understand that Jesus himself is fusing the ancient prophecy about him with this act of entrance. They did not understand these things, it said. John recounts also later on in the chapter that as they conducted themselves, as the Pharisees even and the scribes conducted themselves, it says, though he had done so many signs before them, they still did not believe in him, so that the word spoken by the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled, Lord, who has believed what he heard from us? And in verse 39, we hear him say, therefore, they could not believe. For again, Isaiah said, he has blinded their eyes and hardened their heart. The disciples are not afraid to show the fact that they could not understand these things. We go out into the world bearing witness of Christ Jesus and knowing that, in some ways, it does not come to a logical demonstration. It doesn't come by virtue of that. It comes by the power of God himself, who comes down and comes to take this throne of the cross, not a throne of this world. And it says, when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things had been written about him and had been done to him. And John has a peculiar understanding of what glorification of Jesus means. And it does not mean what we think. It means this, as Jesus says in this same chapter, now is the Son of Man glorified, and God will be glorified in him. Immediately he will be glorified, and he's speaking of him being lifted upon the cross. When Jesus is glorified, then his disciples understood these things. They come to understand that the power that Jesus possesses is not one particularly shown in the victory over this world in that form, but instead he comes to die. And he comes to mark out his kingdom in this way, that it is a kingdom of humility and service. He did not come to be served, but to serve. The crowd that had been with him when he called Lazarus, you know, all came with him. And then the Jews that heard about this in Jerusalem, you know, Bethany was a short ways from Jerusalem. They all come out and they're all together, lift him up upon this cloud. And then once again, we see in verse 19, the Pharisees gather together. And they're not so impressed with this crowd. Nothing is worse than a group of people who have lost their way and who are now desperate to hold on to power in any way possible. And this is what the Pharisees were. They saw the masses running to him, and they saw that their base was leaving them. Their base is leaving them, and their whole lifestyle is called into question. Everything that they're about, Jesus is taking away. And they're desperate to retain this power, and they are blinded by their jealousy over it. And they're blinded by the jealousy that they have toward him. And so they start chewing on each other. It says the Pharisees said to one another, look, you're doing nothing good. Look at this. The whole world has gone after him. You morons. And they begin to concoct a plan together with the chief priests and the scribes. And as we hear, they couldn't help themselves. I say this once again because we come to the scriptures again and again. We see this amazing power of God worked in Christ Jesus, and we think to ourselves, well, isn't it just simply obvious? Not only is it not obvious, but we would say, isn't it easily done where God, through these means, just kind of, you know, leverages his power to bring them over? And then we hear John say such stark and arresting things about these people that though he had done so many things for them, still they could not believe in him because he has hardened their heart against him. Such that they would have to do this. They were bound to it. And God would subject himself to this necessity. Jesus would play into that hand. And he would give himself over to the will of his Father. The will of his Father, for it pleased him, as Isaiah writes, to crush him. The Pharisees are ultimately right in witnessing the whole world goes after him. What's even more blessed is that from their ranks, from those enemies of God, Jesus selected one of them and lay hold of him on the way to Damascus, as Saul was on his way. A Pharisee of Pharisees, perfect according to the law, enraged at the Christian people because of their defection from God's purpose in the law. He was going after them to eradicate this new movement. And God from these ranks takes one of their own and turns him from his darkness and turns him from his blindness and gives him a brand new life and calls him into his service. And so even though Paul himself, who was not named Paul before, but Saul himself was just like one of these men. You're not doing anything good. Look, the whole world has gone after him. And now he himself is converted. He himself comes to face Jesus face to face. And really what we come to is this. John has this incredible peacefulness about him. Because as he writes this letter, he said, if everything Jesus did and said were written in the books, the whole world wouldn't contain the books. But these are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, and that by believing in him, you may have life in his name. And now God has given us this witness likewise, that as we carry forth this gospel, as this word is proclaimed, God will do this work. And we leave it to him to do it. Because he's capable of doing it. We don't have to do this. God will do this. And in the simplicity of this witness, he will make new people out of those who are committed to that ancient contagion of death, which is sin. He will grab them out of that by the simplicity of this message. And then indeed the world will go after him. God will reverse that pattern of man that still pursues power. God will reverse it and place in the world a kingdom that is not like anything that we've ever seen. The world has gone after him. Because the world, yes, is loved by him. He loved the entire world so that he would give his only begotten Son. For he did not come to condemn this world, but to save it. May God continue to fit us with his Spirit that we would go out and simply bear witness to this Jesus. Sometimes in the simplest way that we can, and in the most straightforward, but ultimately trusting that he will do this work. He will make this kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's turn to him in prayer. Heavenly Father, we ask that you would bless us. We thank you, Lord, that you came to throw yourself into this world entirely, to experience the entirety of all of it. From the cradle in Bethlehem into this moment of effusive praise, Lord, you came to know all of it with us. And Heavenly Father, we pray that you would please help us in all of life's trials and in all of life's situation, that we would come to rely upon your strength and to rely upon your faithfulness. We pray, Lord, even as we traverse through this Holy Week season, that you would open our hearts and our mind's eye, that we might perceive and know the good things that you have for us. Help us, Heavenly Father, to shine your light. For Jesus' name's sake, we pray. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you of his everlasting peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Probably appropriate to stand for this final.